Good morning, Sandy Pines. Welcome to each of you on this Lord's Day. This is Pentecost Sunday, and we celebrate the presence of God's Holy Spirit living among us and in us. This morning, we're going to be led in music by Faithful Journey Quartet. They were actually scheduled to sing for us next Sunday night, and they gracefully agreed to come and sing for us this morning. They're going to lead us now in a couple of precious old hymns that we enjoy so much. Thank you, Faithful Journey, for being with us this morning.
I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now. My Savior, I come to thee. Hear my cry, hear my prayer from the ends of the earth. I'm calling to you. Oh, my heart has no strength. Lord, lead me back to the rock that is true. Hear my cry. Tower, my light and darkest hour, sustainer and provider, my ever-present help, be my comfort, my foundation, my healer, my salvation, redeemer and protector, my ever-present help, be my strong, triumphant tower. Tower, sustainer and provider, my ever-present help, be my comfort, my foundation, my healer, my salvation, redeemer and protector, my ever-present help. I need thee, oh. Every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to Thee. Oh, I need Thee. Oh, I need Thee. My soul.
All right, time for the children's message. Hey, I know I can't call like kids to me right now, but I can say, hey, kids, if you would just come a little closer to the TV or your iPad or computer or whatever it is, because I want to talk just to you, right? So parents, grandparents, like, you just talk amongst yourselves for a second, right? I just want to talk to kids. All right, kids, today in the sermon, I'm going to talk about how this guy Peter, because he loved Jesus so much, he was able to heal a man who was paralyzed, right? And there's an act of love that he performs that helps this man walk again. And right now, right, in this time where, like, you've been out of school or doing school online, whatever it is, right, it's just a little confusing, a little up in the air. And right now, right, people miss each other, right? They miss being around each other. They miss seeing each other. And we can't just go around hugging people and, like, hugging our grandparents and all that stuff like we want to. But there are ways that we can, like, you know, love people and let them know that they're loved by us and by God. And that's right, if you can, like, write a letter to your grandparents or your teacher, you know, or a friend you haven't seen since school ended, or you can color a picture if you can't write, you know, do something like that. Your parents can help you with the mailing and the address and the stamp and all the not fun stuff, right? Like, I can tell you from experience right now, my refrigerator is covered in colored pictures from kids from my church. And it just, I love it because it makes me remember, right, that, like, I love them, I'm praying for them, I care for them, and it reminds me that I'm loved as well, right? It's just a way that we can come alongside each other and love each other, right? Or let's say, like, your folks who aren't listening or shouldn't be listening right now are like, hey, we need you to, like, clean your room or something like that, that when you do it, like, you do it without grumbling and complaining, and then on top of it, maybe you go, like, clean the family room or help with dishes, right? We go above and beyond right now, right, to show our parents love. You know, if there's something outside you can do, like yard work, whatever it is, right, to step up and to help your parents right now in a time that's a little confusing or hard to figure out. But either way, right, like, just because you're a kid or whatever age you are doesn't mean you can't serve God and love people. So right now, one way you can serve God is to, right, send letters, color pictures, right, help out at home, whatever it is, right, like, it's a way for you to show your parents that you care and love them. So let me pray for you quick. All right, Father God, thank you so much for these kids. I pray a blessing upon them as their school year has come to an end or is coming to an end. I pray that this summer it's fun and it's healthy and safe, and they can get back to a life of laughing and goofing around and enjoying the life that you've given them. And I pray now that they serve you to the best of their ability, whatever that may be. I just pray again that they're healthy and safe throughout the rest of this summer. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jason, for that message. Just a couple of announcements this morning. First of all, reminder that tonight our concert has been canceled. Also for next Sunday night, it has been canceled. We will continue to air our morning worship on YouTube as well as through our Sandy Pines TV station. So continue to tune in and enjoy our worship time together. We also would like to one more time share with you that you can continue to support our chapel ministry here at Sandy Pines. There's a box outside the public safety building. Feel free to make your donations there. Feel free also to put your prayer request there. And then you can also send your gifts in to Sandy Pines Chapel, right to our Sandy Pines office here at Sandy Pines. I invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this glorious Lord's Day. We thank you that we come together as your people here to worship the God that we simply love. And we thank you on this Lord's Day that we celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit, a Spirit who came to your people who rests within us, for Lord, we are that temple. And as the presence of the Holy Spirit is with us on this Lord's Day, we just pray that our hearts will be open to your words. We come to worship you, we've come to praise you today. And then as well, Lord, we lift up the needs of those around us. We remember our chapel members, some of them who are suffering with illness. Yes, Lord, it could be this horrendous virus that's going through the entire world. We pray for those, Lord, with other health issues as well. We pray, Lord, for those with economic issues, jobs that have been lost, jobs that are not in session right now. And Lord, we just pray that you will walk with us through these days. And so, Lord, at this time, we pray, Lord, for our leaders as they lead us through this time. We thank you, Lord, for Sandy Pines. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful place we've come to love and we can enjoy. And again, Lord, we pray for our board here. We pray for our park director. We pray for the entire staff that, yes, you'll keep them healthy and that you'll also give them guidance as to how they are to lead us this summer. We thank you again for this beautiful park, for wonderful friends we have here. And now, Lord, as we continue our worship time, we pray that you will bless this time and that you will be honored through it. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. We continue our worship time, and again, Faithful Journey is going to lead us in a song or two. Thank you again, Faithful Journey. We look forward to your songs at this time.
I walk by the tomb of Buddha, looked inside and saw his bones, traveled on to see Muhammad, still wrapped up in his grave clothes. Then I journeyed to a garden where old Joseph left him laid, the precious lamb, God's only begotten, was no longer in that grave. If you knew him like I know him, you would know that he's alive. If you felt him like I inside, you know he's living, and death has died. If you're wandering in the darkness, come and step into the light. Nail-scarred hands out to help you, to pull you safe from death to life. Friend, I too have been there with you. Could I trust on things unseen? Oh, but just one step in his direction, then in love he ran to me. If you knew him like I know him, you would know that he's alive. If you felt him like I feel him,
beside them every day. He stood in line, he paid taxes like them all. He ate their bread and drank their wine, yet they never understood his secret call. Then he told him of a kingdom that would never have an end. And though they did not understand it, they saw God as he became their closest friend. He laughed with them, cried with them, in the joy and the pain he was there. When the wind and rain obeyed his voice, they saw in him the one who answered prayer. He spoke peace to their troubled hearts, calm the storm that raged inside of them. He was more than Messiah, he was their closest friend. There was something in the way he could look into your eyes like he knew you. There was something in the way he could speak a word and change your point of view. As if he knew your secret thoughts, saw your failures, and he understood your fears. Then something set your spirit free, and you knew your closest friend was here. He laughed with them, cried with them, in the joy pain he was there. When the wind and waves obeyed his voice, they saw in him the one who answered prayer. He spoke peace to their troubled heart and calmed the storm that raged inside of them. Was more than Messiah, he was their closest friend.
Though we may not understand all the ways that God would lead us, yet we know that he is still the same as the one who walked on water, raise the dead and heal the broken, and he listens when we call on his name.
He spoke peace to my troubled heart and calmed the storm that raged inside of me. He is more than my Savior, he is my closest friend.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to care. In prayer. endless pain we bear, all because we do not carry. Everything to God in prayer.
He is more than my Savior. He is my closest friend.
To lead us in God's Word this morning, we're honored to have with us Reverend Jason Pierce. Reverend Pierce comes to us from the Niekerk Christian Reformed Church. It's interesting that when he was just a little kid, he used to visit our chapel quite regularly. His mom is Linnell Pierce, and Linnell has given us probably 15 to 20 concerts here in the past. Jason used to come along as a little kid. So Jason, thank you for coming back to Sandy Pines, and thank you for coming this morning to lead us in the message from God's Word.
Well, good morning, Sandy Pines. Again, my name is Pastor Jason. It's an honor to get to worship with you today. I was really looking forward to worshiping with you in person, since I've spent so many years here with my mom singing here. But you know what? We're in different times right now, and that's okay. It doesn't stop us from worshiping the Lord. The fact that we're not in the same room or building together, that's okay, right? Because the Spirit is what's holding us together, and it's the Spirit that brings our worship to God this morning. So I want to start with prayer, and then we're going to jump into Acts chapter 3, if you want to follow along in your Bible. So let's pray. Father, Son, and Spirit, we come before you this morning grateful for another day, grateful for a breath that goes in and out of our lungs and a heart that keeps beating, all because you're in control. We thank you so much for the grace that you give us. And now this morning, Father, we pray that you move your Spirit through us so that we're open to hearing your word, that you move in our minds and in our hearts. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, so I'm just going to read Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10 this morning. It says, "One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer at 3:00 in the afternoon. And a man lame from birth was being carried in. People would lay him daily at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate, so that he could ask for alms from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go in the temple, he asked them for alms. Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, 'Look at us.' And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, 'I have no silver or gold, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk.' And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Jumping up, he stood and began to walk, and he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God, and they recognized him as the one who used to sit and ask for alms at the Beautiful Gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So when I was reading through this passage, like, the first thing that came to mind was, like, there's this beggar, right, this paralyzed beggar. And it's so easy for me as a believer, as somebody in need of God's grace, to just think, like, right, we can put ourselves in this story right there really quick, right? Like, we're all beggars in a sense. Right? There's a song by a band, like, I'm positive none of you have ever heard of, but they have a song called Beggars, and in the song it says, "If there's one thing I know in this life, it's that we're beggars all." Right? And what the singer is saying, right, he's like, We can't make the earth spin around the sun, right? We don't choose where we're born. There's so many things, really everything, like we don't have control over. What we need most is God and grace, right? We're all beggars in need of God and His love, right? And I think that'd be an easy place to focus today. But instead, the thing that really jumped out at me that I want to share with you today is Peter's story, like who Peter is in this story and how he served this man, right? Because Peter, right, I mean, just 3 years ago was a fisherman. And now, like a little over 3 years later, he's healing a paralyzed beggar, right? How did we get there? Right? How did this take place? So before we jump into that, I want to tell you a story. And I just want to preface the story with, I'm not telling this story to make me look good or sound good or whatever, and I'll get to that later. But I just don't want you to think that while I'm telling you this story. So about 5 years ago, I have two kids at the time. I have three boys now, but I had two then. And they were 8 and 7. And we lived on the south side of Holland, and I was going to bring my boys downtown to walk around. And I'm the kind of person who drives their car like to the point of running on fumes every time before I get gas. Why? I don't know. It's just, maybe it like gets my adrenaline going. I don't know. But it's what I do. So I'm taking my boys downtown Holland, and I realize like, oh, I don't think we're going to make it. So I pull in the gas station. I get out, right? My boys are both strapped in back, and I'm pumping gas. And while I'm pumping the gas, my oldest son knocks on the window. And I open his door, already prepared to say, no, I'm not going to go in and get you candy. But he points off to the side, and he said, what's that man doing? And I look, and you know how there are like garbage cans between different gas pumps. And there was a man probably in his like mid to late 60s, right? Like hair and beard, like he had just come out of like the COVID-19 quarantine, right? Just rough. But he just looked rough. And he's digging through the garbage. And I said to my son, I was like, you know, he's probably looking for food or pop cans, probably like cans, right? Because he can get 10 cents a can. And my son's like, why would he do that? I'm like, well, you know, he probably doesn't have any money. There's a good chance, right? He either lost a job or has a mental health issue, or maybe he just chooses this life. I don't know, right? But that was kind of the day where my two oldest sons, right? Where life stopped being just like Legos and video games and like walks in the park, right? Like they saw the real world right then. So I finished pumping gas and I got in my car, and I'd been thinking about it the whole time. And I sat down and I was like, I looked in the back and I was like, well, what do you guys want to do about this, right? What can we do? And obviously they didn't have any idea other than they thought we should help. And I grabbed my wallet, which I think is probably the simplest thing to do and not always the best thing to do. But I grabbed my wallet and I opened it, and one of the rarest things that have ever happened in my life happened. Like, I just so happened to have $100 bill. It's very rare in my time. Like, I don't carry money, especially that much money. And I saw it and I pulled it out and I gave it to my oldest son and I said, why don't you guys go give this to him? So they unbuckled and they got out of the car, and I got out of the car and I stayed by the car. And they walked across the gas station and they handed this guy the money. They never said a word. And I heard the man say, thank you. And he looked up at me and waved, and I waved back. And it was just like my kids got in the car and we went downtown. And right, I tell you that story, one, because like one of my kids brought it up a couple weeks ago. Right, so 5 years later, it was still an extremely powerful moment for them. It was a teaching moment for them. And I said I was going to preface that I'm not all that great and perfect all the time. I'm not, right? That was a great thing I taught my kids in the moment. I can promise you I've taught my kids a bunch of terrible things as well. If you talk to my congregation, anytime I'm at a four-way stop with other cars, I teach my kids bad lessons, right? Because it's not a courtesy contest. It's like, you get there, it's your turn to go. So anyway, I get a little frustrated and my kids get to see that. So I'm far from perfect. But the thing is, with this story in Acts, when Peter stops to talk to this beggar and heals him of his ailment, right? It's because Peter had the perfect teacher. Again, I was so far from a perfect teacher for my kids, but I'm trying. Right? Peter had the perfect teacher. Again, so just over 3 years ago, right, Peter's on a boat with his brother, and this teacher comes and says, hey, why don't you come fish for people? And they choose to follow him. And the first thing that happens is they go to a synagogue. And now they hear Jesus teaching in a way they've never heard before. And then from there, in the synagogue, there's a man with an unclean spirit, and Jesus performs an exorcism. So you're in the first moments, you're like following this rabbi, and this is what's happening. And then from there, they go to Peter's house where his mother-in-law has a fever, and Jesus heals her. And then the rest of that evening, Jesus heals any sick person or a person with an unclean spirit. Like the rest of the night, anybody that comes, he heals. So what Peter's learned is, right, to follow this rabbi, right, you're following somebody who preaches in a different way, right, who can heal people like from evil spirits and can heal people that are sick. And then from there, right, Jesus goes and he calls Matthew, a tax collector, like one of the most hated people around. And then he takes Matthew, right, and they go to Matthew's house with all these other tax collectors, and it said all the tax collectors and sinners. So now the lesson that Peter has is, right, you preach, right, you heal, and you walk alongside and love the people that most people won't love. Right? These are the lessons that Peter is hearing over and over, and it's what he's seeing over and over and over. Right? With the perfect teacher, right, Peter knew how to interact with people. So now if we jump back to Acts 3, you have Peter and John walking into the temple, right, for this time of prayer. And some people like to believe that when Jesus like came and lived and died and rose again and ascended back to heaven, like that all of the old traditions were gone and done. And that's not the case. Right? Jesus didn't say that they were worthless. He was saying that if your heart's not in it, why are you doing it? Right? You can't earn, ritual and tradition can't earn you like a place in heaven. So Peter and John are going to the temple to pray because they love God and they want to talk to God. And on their way there, this man cries out, right, for money, for help. And I think we can all relate to this, right? Like we've all been like driving in a car and we've stopped at like, you know, like you get off a highway overpass and there's somebody standing with that cardboard sign, right? Like homeless, we'll work for food, whatever it says, right? Or maybe you've walked the Miracle Mile in Chicago, right? And you have people sitting, right, every other store basically holding signs that'll say like, you know, Vietnam veteran, homeless, like need help, whatever it is, right? And I don't expect you to be perfect, and I'm not perfect, right? There's this moment that happens, right, where we make eye contact, right? Because we see what's happening. We see the person asking for help, and they see us walking by, right? And more often than not, then there's that quick, like, turn away. Like, I'll just pretend I didn't see you, and you can just pretend you didn't see me. There's a sense of, I don't know if it's embarrassment or what it is, but like we don't know what to do with it. And here, right, we have this person crying out for help. And what Peter and John do is they stop immediately. And from the looks of it, this man had already looked away, right, in that moment of like maybe shame. But Peter and John get there and Peter's like, look at us. Look at us, right? Before we get into any more of it, right? That phrase, look at us. It's because Peter saw this person the way Jesus would see this person, the way God sees everybody. It's like that's not a crippled beggar on the side of the road. That's a child of God created in God's image on the side of the road who needs help. So Peter says, look at us. Because we see you. And look, obviously we don't have anything. Like we've basically been homeless for the last 3 years. We have nothing to give you. But what we can give you in the name of Jesus Christ is the ability to walk again. Right? So Peter says, you get up now, right? In the name of Jesus. And right, he gets up, right? Ankles and feet healed. Like there's no rehab, right? There's no time like in Grand Rapids at the hospital, like being like, well, we're going to take baby steps before you walk. I mean, this guy is jumping and dancing and praising the Lord. And what I want to point out here is what Peter didn't do. Peter didn't say to this man, you know what, before I help you, I need to hear your testimony. He didn't say, hey, before I help you, are you Reformed? Or are you Wesleyan? Like, do you believe all of the right things? That's not what happened. Right? Peter saw somebody who needed love, and he gave it. Why? Because that's what he learned from his teacher. Right? And too often, like the church especially likes to teach people that the way that you help people is you tell them about Jesus. And I believe that to be true fully, 100%. But it's like there are two classes that we should take when we give our life to the Lord. One, how to proclaim the name of Jesus. And two, how to love our neighbor as ourselves. And too often, it's like we skip one of those classes. And then come test time, like, we're going to fail. Right? The deal is, you love people, right, physically, and you love people enough to let them know that Jesus loves them. Right? I'm not saying that one is more important than the other. I'm saying that they're both needed. Right? If we've committed our lives to God, then right, our call is to walk alongside people, love people, even the unlovable people, because that's what God does. That's what Jesus taught, and that's the call for us. So, there's a guy at our church, Ray. Ray passed away during this pandemic, and he's the kind of guy who, like, I imagine thousands of people would have showed up to his funeral, and that would have upset him. Because he never wanted any celebration or glory for himself. It was always glory for God. And Ray was in his mid-90s. But Ray did prison ministry, and he would go sing places. But like, and he was a farmer. He's just a good old guy. And he lived in Hamilton. And one day, like about 10, 15 years ago, he had a guy knock on his door. And he said, the guy came to the door and said, hey, I have my kids here, and I don't have anything. Like, could you help us find a place to stay? And Ray, whose heart is bigger than his body, and his wife is the same, right, he was like, well, you can just stay here. And immediately, Ray and his wife went to the basement and created this space for a man and his three boys to live. And they lived there for over a year. And in that time, Ray became really good friends with them, right, as like a grandpa and a father figure, and got to present the gospel to these people. Right? First, it was like Ray saw them in need, and he helped them. And then in the course of their relationship, he got to show them who Jesus was and teach them about who Jesus is, right? Like who Jesus is in Ray's life and who can be in their lives. And I met one of these boys about a year ago. And he just said, all I know is that if Jesus is anything like Ray, then it's somebody I want to follow. Right? To which I got to explain, like, but he's so much more than Ray. Right? Because Jesus gave his life for you. Right? But this idea of, like, there's an action involved in loving God. Right? And the teacher showed us what to do. Right? He showed us that it's not just our friends, not just our family. It's everybody is created in the image of God, and everybody deserves to be seen that way. So whether it's here at Sandy Pines and there are people that you don't get along with or people that don't believe the same thing you believe, like it doesn't mean you don't love them. Right? It means that you stop and you listen to them and you show them love. Right? Or whether it's somewhere else in your normal communities, whether it's at work, wherever it is. Right? It could be school, anywhere. Right? The call from Jesus Christ, right, for his followers is to see people the way he sees them and love them the way he loved them, no matter how difficult it is. Right? So the challenge that I have for you all, the challenge I have for myself, right, this act of worship is like, is to right, strive to like make effort to see the people on the side of the road, to see the people that we would normally walk by, and stop and let them know that you hear them and you see them, and that in the name of Jesus Christ that you love them. Right? And it's, you're not going to be perfect, you're not going to get it right always, but that's the beauty, right? Because we're talking about a man, Peter, who was called by Jesus, but then over and over and over screwed things up, got things wrong, right? Denied that he was even a follower of Jesus, right? But God in his grace through Jesus Christ forgives these failures, forgives these screw-ups, forgives even the times we deny that he's our Savior, right? We're forgiven in his name so that we can go love and forgive in the same way. Right? That's the God that we've gathered to serve. That's the Savior that we've gathered to serve, right? Love God and love neighbor. Serve God and serve neighbor. That's the call. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that the Holy Spirit brings it alive and speaks to our hearts. And now, Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit opens our eyes to see our neighbors, to see those who need love. Give us the strength and the discernment to know how to love people correctly and how to love people in your name. Because without you, it's just like hitting a gong. It's just a sound. It's just noise. But if we love people in your name, it's a testimony to how great you are. So thank you so much again for this story and for your word. It's in your name we pray. Amen. As you go into the rest of your day and the rest of your week, go with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and bring you his peace now and forevermore. Amen.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. And there is only one salvation, we believe, we believe. Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. Faith be more than anthem.
greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life.
We believe.